Thank you. The final item of business is a members' business debate on motion 11864 in the name of Kate Forbes on the economic contribution of the third sector in Scotland. This debate will be concluded without any questions being put, and I would invite those members who would wish to speak in the debate to please press the request to speak buttons, and I call on Kate Forbes to open the debate. Around 7 minutes, please.
Thank you so much, Presiding Officer. I think everybody in this chamber is familiar with the incredible reach, depth and variety across the third sector. Right now, they are working to reduce inequality, to improve health outcomes, to increase the well-being of our citizens, to provide housing, to cement community cohesion, to provide opportunities. The list goes on, and I'm sure that we will hear through the contributions that are made by every individual member just how far that reach goes. The third sector genuinely covers every area of Scotland, both in terms of the area in which they are working and also the geography. To do that, they're employing people, creating jobs. They're purchasing and procuring goods and services. They're engaging in commercial activity. In short, one of their aims and objectives, above and beyond all the other tasks that they do, is to generate wealth. In fact, you could argue that the third sector in Scotland today is doing far more to level up than any national strategy, because of its presence and its effort in every region of Scotland. Some of the best work that I've certainly seen in particular subject areas is delivered by the third sector. Highland Home Care do an incredible job, pioneering work when it comes to training care workers and delivering care. Just earlier today, I met with a fostering and adoption charity that is rising to the challenge that was set by the Scottish Government in terms of recruiting more foster carers. They are relieving hunger across Scotland through the provision of food banks. They're working to provide opportunity for sports, for music, and for employment in every part of Scotland. I'm thinking back to some of the work that I've previously engaged with in terms of setting out Scotland's 10-year economic strategy. So many of the goals that are set out in that strategy are already being delivered by organisations in the third sector. Some of the ways in which the third sector contributes to the economy are obvious. I've already mentioned that they are an employer, that they purchase goods and services, and of course that they invest in buildings and equipment. But I think it's absolutely essential, and that's what this report that is under debate today does, it's absolutely essential that we think of the economy in a different way if we really want a sustainable and an inclusive economy. We want to see how to ensure that well-being is embedded in our delivery of economic goods to all of Scotland's community. One of the ways that they do that is, of course, supporting people to become economically active through employability programmes, and they are able to reach people that so often the state and the Scottish Government and its agencies are unable to reach. They also fund research and development programmes, and so, of course, while Scottish Government funding is absolutely essential when it comes to research and development, so often the third sector, through fundraising and so on, is able to invest in research and development that government or indeed the private sector isn't able to. They're also able to tackle issues such as mental health, poverty, and promoting a healthy workforce in a slightly more nimble and agile way, perhaps. And lastly, of course, social enterprises are creating new markets and organisations by altering cultural norms of behaviour, as well as contributing to changes in consumer preferences. And what's so interesting about social enterprises is that some of them identify as being in the private sector and others identify as being in the third sector. But if there is one challenge facing the third sector, as defined in this report, is the challenge in being adequately defined and therefore its contribution being properly quantified. The third sector, as we have already discussed and will discuss over the course of this debate, is not homogeneous. Interestingly, the SCVO identifies social care and housing as the two largest activities by income, followed by culture and sport, community work, education, health and religion. But these organisations can vary from very small local organisations staffed entirely by volunteers all the way through to national or indeed international charities employing hundreds or in some cases thousands of people. The Fraser Allender Institute says that third sector organisations contribute significantly to most sectors of the economy. And if you want proof of that, just ask yourself, what would our economy look like without that sector operating in that area? And so that is why tonight's debate is so important, because I think everybody in this chamber shares our objective to deliver a sustainable and inclusive economy. The economy is the backbone of so much of the other work that we do. And yet, none of our aims in the economy can be achieved through the private sector or the public sector working independently of the third sector. We absolutely need the third sector as part of our efforts to build a sustainable and inclusive economy. And that calls on all of us to acknowledge the work that they do and also to try and get a grip in terms of the actual quantum of work they do so that we can include that more obviously in our discussions about the economy. The third sector does need a parity of esteem with the private and public sectors when we're talking about economic development. And my last comment, Presiding Officer, as I draw to a close, is that the only hope any of us have of solving whatever economic challenge it is that is under debate is by working across the third sector, private sector and the public sector. And that calls on us to acknowledge the work that the voluntary and the third sector do and to pay tribute and to ensure that that's not just through rhetoric alone, but actually they are embedded in national economic strategies and indeed in our budgets. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Forbes. And I now call Ruth Maguire to be followed by Miles Briggs. Ms Maguire.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'd like to congratulate Kate Forbes for securing this important debate and in highlighting the positive impact of charities, community and voluntary groups and other non-profit distributing organisations. Third sector organisations are often the backbone of any community. They'll offer a range of services, often helping to alleviate societal difficulties such as food poverty, and loneliness and social isolation. They generally make life better. I'm sure everyone here can think of many organisations across their constituency who do just that. For myself, from the community larders providing access to groceries and Clasp Hope Project and their work with older citizens, to the larger charities like Bernardo's and Aberlour, just to name a few. And with the Westminster-induced cost of living crisis, it is these types of organisations who are helping to plug gaps in previously funded, publicly funded services, while, the same as everyone else, navigating rising costs and inflation. In doing so, they contribute and help reduce public expenditure, as was highlighted by the Royal Society of Edinburgh. Thousands of organisations who help to balance our delicate social fabric. During my time as convener back in 2019 of the Equalities and Human Rights Committee, we published a report about valuing the third sector. In that report, the economic contribution of the third sector was recognised to be comparably higher than the whisky industry and not far behind the Scottish tourism sector. Recent figures published by SCVO for 2022 showed that the economic contribution was now £9.2 billion, up from £8.5 billion in 2021, while spending was £8.8 billion, up from £7.9 billion in 2021. Now, despite the growth in the third sector, its contributions remain obscured, as outlined by Kate in her opening, and its struggles are pretty unrelenting. Age Scotland reported in the findings from their survey, Keeping the Doors Open, in June 2022, that securing funding was a recurring issue. They expressed views that multi-year funding would be beneficial for increased financial security and the delivery of longer-term projects, and that single-year funding models, which required them to show their impact in just a year, made it more likely that they would only be able to interact with communities they already engaged with. Another thing that was picked up in that 2019 report I was speaking about was the impact on staff of single-year funding. And of course, these staff employed in our communities are hugely important. The Royal Society of Edinburgh's report, echoed by the SCVO's latest finding from the Scottish Third Sector Tracker, continues to identify finances as a top priority. I understand that the Scottish Government are working with other statutory funders to consider how partnership working can be encouraged in a competitive funding environment, and I'd be interested to know how their findings are being used to design and develop meaningful collaboration between all sectors. Economic activity should serve a purpose to meet everyone's basic needs and improve our collective health and well-being so that all of Scotland's people and places can thrive and prosper. The voluntary sector meets the vision of the National Strategy for Economic Transformation by harnessing innovation, entrepreneurship, research and development, partnership and prevention, and supporting people into employment. Building successful, trusting relationships between the third and public sectors is achievable. We saw it during the pandemic. The third sector played a key role in supporting the public sector, and it was evident that existing relationships became stronger and new ones were created. There was the removal of bureaucratic barriers alongside joined-up working, which empowered people to work together quickly and efficiently. That made such a difference to folk on the ground. It was a better way of working. So fairer funding opportunities, balanced power and resources for third sector organisations can help overcome barriers and recognise our vision for Scotland as a wellbeing economy. Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Ms McGuire. I call Miles Briggs to be followed by Fossil Chowdhury. Mr Briggs.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And can I start by congratulating Kate Forbes on securing this members' debate? It's a really important, I hope, opportunity for us to celebrate our charitable and third sectors in Scotland, but also to acknowledge the positive economic contribution which the third sector is making to Scotland. And as has just been mentioned, I think all of us recognised that during the pandemic and just where the third sector stepped up to help our society. I'd like to also thank the organisations which provided useful briefings ahead of today's debate as well. And it just really shows you the vital impact, some of the statistics which the Royal Society of Edinburgh and the Scottish Council for Voluntary Organisations have provided us ahead of this debate. And certainly the economic statistics, I hadn't been fully aware of that impact. When you look towards potentially £7.9 billion being spent in 2021, now up to £8.8 billion of sector spending in the country, that is huge and incredibly important, and impacts on everyone's lives. I think that's one of the things which this debate has already shown. Now, it's also important to recognise the positive impact the charitable and third sector is making, not only to reduce, but to maximise public expenditure, either by providing services in our health, social care or education sectors, and often doing that better than our NHS or our local authorities as well. And I say that because it often the third sector and charitable sector will take a more innovative or sector or person-specific solution forward. And I think that's something we should celebrate and often capture, is vital we capture that. And I'll give you an example of that here in my own region in Lothian. NHS Lothian, looking at what were waiting times for CAM services, will have often heard complaints from MSPs saying that's unacceptable just to leave people on long waiting lists. Now, they've embraced a lot of work with the third sector to review CAMS cases and get them in where appropriate to early intervention run by mental health charities, and that's really helping to support families and individuals instead of just leaving them on a waiting list. So I think there are some really innovative solutions we should all celebrate and want to see expanded. Kate Forbes said, and I agree, that we also need to look towards the third sector in playing more of a national role in our society, but also being at the table. both in terms of national and regional economic strategies, but also, I think, in terms of where Parliament needs to allow them in as well. One of the problems I think we as a Parliament and governments, including this one but previous ones, have failed in an opportunity is around letting the third sector in earlier. So the integration of health and social care, I think it was a mistake not to have the third sector at the table earlier on. And I would say to ministers, in terms of the development of the National Care Service, let's not make that mistake again. There's an opportunity, I think, as we see that progress through Parliament, to embed the third sector's opportunity. If I've got some time, happy to.
Yes, yeah. Emma Harper.
Just a quick thank you very much, Madam Speaker, for taking the intervention. I am on the committee that's doing the National Care Service evidence gathering, and we have included the third sector in our evidence sessions. Would you welcome that? Because I think that is something that is absolutely, you're right, it's valuable.
Through the chair, Miles Briggs.
No, I absolutely agree. I think when it comes to decision making, though, and the commissioning of services, where they actually are at a table is going to be really important, because a lot of the work they've done beyond the integration of health and social care has been outside of the room. And I think it's really important we make sure that they are there commissioning services and being at the heart of budget conversations. And I say that, and members will be aware of the private members bill consultation that I've launched around a right to palliative care. And I think that's really important, an example of where the hospice sector are not embedded in the conversations around budgeting, and decisions taken by government is seeing them actually facing a £16 million black hole in staffing budgeting. So that is an example of where I think we need to really embed them in decision making. Members will be aware, the CHAS reception down in the Garden Lobby after this event, but there's so many organisations doing such fantastic work that we really need to celebrate them, but also note where we need to, as a Parliament, also engage better with them to open up opportunities for them to do more and actually make a bigger difference. So to conclude, I'd like to thank members, and especially Kate Forbes, for bringing this debate forward this evening. I think we have a huge opportunity to encourage and nurture our third sector, and I think that's something all of us would want to celebrate and make sure happens.
Thank you, Mr. Briggs. I call Faisal Chowdhury to be followed by Emma Harper. Mr. Chowdhury.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. First of all, I would like to thank Kate Forbes for bringing this very important debate into the chamber. I've been involved in third sector organisations all my life, and I know how the difficulty third sector organisations go through. Presiding Officer, Scotland's third sector contributes a vital amount of Scottish amount to Scottish society. Sadly, the contribution of this important sector are too often overlooked and undervalued. This is further represented in the Scottish Government funding models, where we see third sector organisations losing out time and time again. In January of this year, I hosted a roundtable for third sector community organisations in the Lothian regions. I was told by many community organisations that the current grant and the funding model is confusing and time-consuming for smaller organisations who don't have dedicated fundraising manager, meaning that smaller third sector community organisations lose out and cannot provide the service that they desperately need in their communities. Acknowledging the economic contribution of the third sector means that accepting the needs for further investment and support to keep this vital organisation up and running. The Royal Society of Edinburgh's report on the economic contribution to the third sector in Scotland highlights that the third sector is often overlooked as a source of wealth generation and rarely included in national or local growth strategies. In order to wrap the vast economic contribution that the third sector makes, we must give it the recognition and funding that it deserves. The Scottish Government has made commitments to a well-being economy, but these commitments cannot be reached without the important work of the third sector. The range of work done by the third sector is incredibly widespread and long-lasting. Since 2020, the increase in the use of food banks, temporary accommodation and energy prices has meant a significant increase in demand for service. During the COVID-19 pandemic and subsequently third sector organisation worked round the clock to provide support. But due to the current financial situation, core funding is reducing and many vital organisations cannot offer the same level of support they once did. We will see the impact of this in our economy if further investments is not made. It is clear that barriers still exist to allowing a wider recognition of the third sector in Scotland. The RSC report highlighted that there appears to be a cultural assistance to involving charities and other social organisations programmes. The report highlighted that charities often feel like they are not taken as seriously or deemed as professional as other organisations. This culture leads to third sector organisations missing out on opportunities to expand and contribute to our economy and society as a whole. Contributions which are vital and which we should support. I welcome this report and hope it will lead to a barrier to access being torn down to third sector organisations to get the recognition and support they deserve. And my apologies, I won't be able to stay until the end due to the Ramadan. Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr. Chowdhury. I now call Emma Harper to be followed by Brian Widdow. Ms. Harper.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I congratulate my colleague Kate Forbes on securing this important debate. And this debate allows us to recognise and promote the importance of the third sector. And Kate Forbes has outlined this very well in leading this debate already. And in terms of its economic contribution to Scotland's economy, including the wellbeing economy, I also thank the organisations for their briefings ahead of this debate this evening. The Royal Society of Edinburgh's research paper highlights so much information, and I would recommend everyone, I know the Chamber colleagues will have read about it, encourage others to read it also. The third sector is an absolutely crucial lifeline to so many of our fellow citizens, supporting people's social needs as well as their physical and mental health. The social enterprise is a diverse mix of business models, as we've heard already, across many industries and rural and urban geographies. This is a key strength. Many social enterprises are registered charities or SCIOs, while many others are community interest companies, cooperatives and other purposeful business models. The economic contribution of Scotland's social enterprises in terms of gross value added income to Scotland's economy is £2.63 billion annually, according to the most recent social enterprise census. And these social enterprises, which together make up the third sector, provide around 90,000 full-time equivalent jobs in Scotland alone, providing Scotland's third sector with a net collective worth of around £7 billion. The third sector, and indeed its social enterprises, are hugely important to Scotland's economy, to our society, and it is right that we celebrate and support the third sector this evening. Presiding Officer, I'd like to touch on the work of Third Sector Dumfries and Galloway. The team led by Alan Webb helps voluntary organisations, charities, social enterprises and cooperatives, credit unions, mutual organisations and volunteers all work together to put the sector first. They highlight what the third sector is, how it impacts upon the lives of individuals and communities in Dumfries and Galloway, and how it impacts on the strength and sustainability of our economy. Third Sector D&G additionally represents the interests of the sector by lobbying opinion creators and decision makers here in the Scottish Government, Dumfries and Galloway Council, and indeed NHS Dumfries and Galloway. So it is essential to value the third sector equitably, as Kate Forbes described. Third Sector Dumfries and Galloway is part of the Third Sector Interface Network, funded by the Scottish Government. The TSI provides a single point of access for support and advice for the sector within local areas. This includes tackling social inequalities, community empowerment, inclusive growth, increasing volunteering and citizenship, and enabling the integration of health and social care. One of the great initiatives which has stemmed from this is increasing the use of social prescribing in the region. We have recently recommended increasing the use of social prescribing at Health Committee, following our social prescribing is an investment, not a cost inquiry that Health Committee did previously. And it is a great way for people to be supported to access treatment in the best interests of their physical and mental health. Presiding Officer, Third Sector G&G, working in collaboration with many groups and organisations like A Listening Ear, the D&G Hard of Hearing Group, DG Voice, the Dumfries and Galloway Advocacy and Food Train, of course, and many others. They all work to support people to become economically active. I volunteered with A Listening Ear during the COVID lockdown to help address isolation and loneliness caused by the lockdown. So all of this work that's been done to support people and promote digital literacy is another thing that is being taken forward. And I think to this end, the Third Sector D&G, and under the leadership of a former CEO, Norma Austin Hart, they did a great study to examine the extent of digital inclusion. So I'm conscious of time, Presiding Officer, but their findings were stark, but it led to great initiatives to support digital literacy hubs. So I thank Kate Forbes again for securing this debate and reaffirm the need to include and value the third sector to support our economy. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Harper. I now call Brian Whittle to be followed by Paul O'Kane.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. Can I also add my congratulations to Kate Forbes for securing time in the Chamber to highlight the importance of the third sector to the Scottish economy. I think the third sector, as members will know, is something I've spoken about many times in this Chamber, and although we talk about them all the time and we heap praise upon them, I'm not quite sure we match that with the way in which we act on their behalf. So I'm very grateful for the opportunity to speak in this debate. And I also would like to thank the Royal Society of Edinburgh for their comprehensive document. As is highlighted in the motion and by previous speakers, the monetary value of the third sector in Scotland would be impossible for any government to replace. I think governments lean on the third sector in an assumption that they can be a cost-effective way of delivering a community service, especially when they often cater for those furthest removed from our society. However, when we talk in terms of economic contribution of the third sector, we should not lose sight of what that means in terms of our communities and the impact it would have on them if they ceased to exist, not to mention the extra burden that would put on our statutory services already creaking under huge pressures. As is customary in these debates, I will talk about some third sector organisations in my own area. Morven Day Services in Onthank, a drop-in centre for those suffering poor mental health, a lifeline for many who, and some of them, it's the only place they see outside of their home a couple of times a week. They use music and art, and I have been beaten several times by many members in there at pool when we drop in there. I partake sometimes in their music because they do have guitars in there. And although you'll be glad to hear, I haven't tried to draw anything in their art classes. But what that does is draw together a lot of like-minded people in a safe environment. Now, that service is under threat. Local council have withdrawn their funding. What worries me is what happens to those members who use that service, because they're not going to walk through the shiny doors of a statutory service. Now, as it happens, they have secured some donations privately, which is going to keep the doors open for the next few months while they try and work through these issues. But I do worry what happens to these very colourful characters, can we say, some fantastic characters, that use that service. What happens to them if Morven Day shuts in Onthank? Likewise, Break the Silence, who work with those who have childhood sexual trauma. Who's going to replace that service if they fall? And if we lose these services, I think my worry is that although it will come out of the cost of the local council ledger, it will come out of the pages of the local council ledger, but it will inevitably reappear in the healthcare ledger at a much greater cost. Similarly, we have things, people like Wish You Were Here, We Are With You, drug and alcohol addiction support, along with recovery enterprises who don't just wait for service users to come to them. They will go out to the service users for those who aren't able to leave their home. And they work with those most removed from society. Foundation Hub, who have support for those detained at His Majesty's pleasure, but who will need to be reintegrated into the community after serving the debt to society. And they work with them 6-8 weeks out to make sure that they have everything they need when they come out. And they also support the families of those who are incarcerated. And there isn't a similar statutory service to replace that. Many of us will know about Centre Stage, who have developed into such a huge community asset and a meeting point. They use music, among other things, to bring people together who otherwise may have nowhere to go and seek help, seek company or seek friendship. Deputy Presiding Officer, the third sector is under increasing financial pressure to deliver what they do, and more often to the most vulnerable in our society. They have the flexibility to adapt to circumstances in a way that statutory services often cannot. And I think in many ways the third sector is taken for granted that they will always be there, that their budgets can be squeezed, and they will continue to deliver the economic, community and human impact that we have been discussing. That will be so vital. Deputy Presiding Officer, we just shouldn't. Because if we do, we'll wake up one day and they won't be there. And then what will we do? Cutting support for a third sector is a false economy, an economy and service we could not replace. Deputy Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr. Whittle. And I call Paul O'Kane. Mr. O'Kane.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. And can I begin by thanking Kate Forbes for securing today's debate. I think for all of us in the Chamber, it's always a pleasure to be able to highlight and speak about the valuable role of Scotland's third sector to our economy and to our society. And in opening, I think Kate Forbes set out a number of the challenges I think they're in a very considered speech. I know well the impact that the third sector has on the ground, working with individuals across Scotland. Indeed, most of my career before coming to this place was spent working in the third sector. And I declare an interest in that regard, having worked for Enable Scotland, as colleagues probably know, before my election to Parliament. So I was able to see up close the work that they and other third sector organisations do, particularly in the learning, disability and social care space. And I think when we often think about the third and voluntary sector, it's perhaps those sorts of engagements that often come to mind, and we've already heard a number of examples from across Scotland in the debate this evening. It's the impact on individuals and society that we see through a third sector organisation and their interactions that have the biggest impact in our communities. And often when we think about the provision of support services to people in our communities, we often see the third sector going above and beyond in terms of their delivery, and often being praised for the high standards that they have adhered to. Indeed, the British Medical Journal, looking at social care services, has found that regulated social care services in the third sector are frequently higher than those in the private sector. And indeed, in terms of people's choice of where they receive care, very often people look to third sector options in order to have that support with an organisation that I suppose they look at in terms of trust and of being rooted in their local community. But of course, there are other examples of where I think that connection and trust is borne out. When it comes to supporting fostering relations, organisations like the Outward Bound Trust are equipping young people in communities across Scotland with skills for life and engaging them in community projects such as the Mark Scott Leadership for Life Award, which we have managed in this chamber to find a consensus around funding for the coming year. And I think that was a really strong piece of work done cross-party in order to secure that important funding, and we hope that that will continue. And of course, there are countless examples, I think, of third sector organisations who need and deserve support from across Scotland. And I think they're at the forefront of our minds in the debate this evening. But what Kate Forbes' motion this evening rightly highlights, and I think that what we don't consider nearly as much, is the large economic impact that these organisations have. And SCVO's sector stats for 2022 estimated that there were 46,500 charities, community groups and social enterprises active in Scotland, employing 135,000 paid staff and supported by over 1 million volunteers, with an estimated turnover of £9.2 billion and spending £8.8 billion in that period. And that's a very significant economic footprint. And we know that other reports have continued to exemplify that, not least the work done by the Royal Society of Edinburgh, which has been referenced here by speakers this evening. I think what we've also heard this evening from colleagues is the importance of ensuring that the third sector can continue to contribute to our growing economy by making sure that they have the certainty in terms of their planning. And that is largely to do with Yes Resource and knowing where the resource is coming from. But it is important in terms of fair funding, ensuring the structures of funding work for these organisations. So I would point, if people haven't already seen it, to SCVO's fair funding asks, of government, where they have called for multi-year funding, they have called for uprating, they have called for a better kind of communication and dialogue, I suppose, in terms of funding awards. And I think we have to reflect on all of that. And indeed, I hope that in summing up, the Minister might be able to say something about the progress of the Fair Funding Review that I know the Government is undertaking, because SCVO are very keen to see quicker progress, I think, in that regard as well. I am conscious of time, Deputy Presiding Officer. I think it's clear that we need to ensure that the third sector are at the heart of our economy here in Scotland, that they are a considered and respected partner, because we realise that the potential the third sector has, and that Kate Forbes's motion rightly highlights, is that the third sector can continue to make a huge contribution to Scotland, not only here in our present, but also in the future. And I think everyone in the Chamber is in agreement in that, but we must do more in order to support our charities across Scotland. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Kane. I now call Minister Emma Roddick to respond to the debate. Around 7 minutes, please, Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I too want to genuinely thank Kate Forbes for bringing this forward, because it is wonderful to have been given this opportunity to focus on the economic advantages of having a thriving third sector. Because as she mentioned in her opening speech, the third sector covers everything in life. There are incredible things going on in the Highlands, which we both represent, from housing provision to mental health support. And I'm so aware that usually, debate in here on the third sector focuses on the need to support the third sector with government funding, which is important, and I'm going to get on to how we are doing that shortly. But it might leave folk with the impression that the third sector is something that costs rather than contributes. And that came through, I think, in Paul O'Kane's contribution. I know from his past work he's got a very valuable insight here, and I too want to welcome the report from the Royal Society of Edinburgh that has been mentioned by him and other members. At a time where I genuinely believe that we must, and that more and more people do, think carefully about where we spend our money supporting local, ethical businesses, the societal impact of the third sector cannot be ignored, but the economic impact is often overlooked. And as Miles Briggs pointed out, the spending that the third sector is responsible for is incredible. And it's hard for me to imagine, for example, the Riverside in the west at Inverness being the hive of activity it is now without Eden Court. And I can say one of the best parts about having a birthday in July is that every year I get to enjoy some of their summer offering. And beyond that, Eden Court is estimated to be worth £11.83 million to the Highland economy, and £7 is generated for every £1 of public funding. But there's also that spend to save element, and we know that the efforts of the third sector in many areas is preventing crises, supporting people and saving lives. I was at the Highland Heroes Awards last week to support Michael O'Neill, who's an emergency community rescue first responder where I grew up in Alness. And he literally rescues people, complementing the work of the ambulance service and community healthcare providers, and truly deserved the recognition of the award that he got. But sitting there, it was incredible to hear the stories of the other nominees who were doing work caring for people at home, preventing deaths by suicide by providing peer support, and finding innovative housing solutions. And as Kate and I both know, and probably spend a lot of time reminding other people, it's local communities who know best how to deliver services in their area. And that gets to the heart of work in my portfolio on addressing depopulation, tackling inequalities, and ending social isolation and loneliness. We have to do that in a way that reaches those furthest from power. And as Brian Whittle pointed out, third sector organisations are reaching those that others, including mainstream services, have not been able to. And what we've heard tonight is how those locally based, locally minded third sector organisations are making a difference across Scotland. They fill gaps and they solve problems that solely profit-driven businesses cannot. Ruth Maguire's shout out to her community larders brought to mind a number that I'm also familiar with, including organisations that we are supporting through our Social Isolation and Loneliness Fund, and countless which sprung up over COVID to ensure that people did not have to travel far for essentials, even if they lived rurally or on an outer island, or in response to the cost of living crisis since. And Ruth was also right to talk about voluntary services in particular, which of course make up a huge part of the third sector. Formal volunteering is estimated to be worth £2.3 billion in Scotland, but we know that the true worth is even higher than that. And since I was very young, even when I've been working multiple jobs, I've always held voluntary roles. And it wasn't just about wanting to do something good, but you get so much out of it. And I only had the energy to get up and go to my other work in the morning because I felt like I had purpose. And I got to spend time with other volunteers who shared my beliefs and knew that we were making a difference to someone. And when we look at social prescribing, mental health recovery, the third sector is leading the way. And that's supporting service users, but also providing a way for those who will benefit from volunteering that opportunity to be part of something and enrich their lives through that volunteering. As Emma Harper said, this is not in opposition to public services, but the partnership working like that, which she described in Dumfries and Galloway, can improve the public sector while maintaining that important role for the third sector. And that means that the value of the money that we are spending on public services goes up because the impact is going further and is worth more. Now, in the Scottish Government, we have a firm commitment to our National Strategy for Economic Transformation, which has an overarching vision for a well-being economy in Scotland that is fair, green and growing, and in which the third sector has an important role to play. Faisal Chowdhury mentioned the need for many third sector organisations to have dedicated staff for making funding applications, and he's absolutely right. I'm supporting at the moment a number of smaller charities to help them make sense of that funding landscape and try to navigate it, and I always say to them, there is a reason that you see so many full-time fundraising officers. And I do recognise that there's a need for government funding to reduce that problem for those that we support and not risk adding to it. So Paul O'Kane was right to raise the fairer funding principles, which we remain committed to, and it's something that we have prioritised despite the very difficult budget situation that we are in, providing that clarity that we know third sector organisations need. And both the Of course.
Paul O'Kane.
I am very grateful to the Minister for giving way. Out of that fair review, a number of two recommendations, I think, have been progressed, including a commitment to notify organisations who are going to be in receipt of two-year funding as part of the pilot by, I think, the end of March. I wonder if the Minister can say anything in terms of the progress of that and whether that target will be met.
Minister.
It's certainly not something I can speak to in detail right now, but I'm more than happy to get Paul O'Kane some more information on that. I know that it is something that the First Minister has been very keen to press with officials across government, that grant conditions and timescales for notification very much need to be improved. So it is an issue that we are aware of, and I'm more than happy to follow up. Both the National Strategy for Economic Transformation and the 2022-23 Programme for Government included a commitment to undertake a review of how to increase the number of co-ops, employee-owned firms and social enterprises in Scotland. And that review will conclude in spring this year. And as we approach the two-year anniversary of that strategy's publication, we recognise that much has changed in that time. A refreshed strategy will provide a clear and concise articulation of the actions that we are taking and will take to achieve our central objective to build that fair, green and growing economy. To fully achieve its economic potential, the third sector needs stability and the opportunity for longer term planning and development. And that is why we do remain committed to fully implementing a fairer funding approach for the third sector. And this year we are focusing on improvements to our grant making arrangements to provide that greater clarity. The Scottish Government is committed to maximising the economic contribution and impact for communities and individuals of the third sector in Scotland. And that includes continued collaborative efforts between the public, private and third sector. And I look forward to playing my part along with colleagues to realise this. But there is always more we can do. And I know that I'll continue to hear from many of the colleagues who have contributed this evening on how we can best reach our shared goal. Thank you.
Thank you, Minister. That concludes the debate and I close this meeting.